just hitting tremendously hard at this point. So you cannot force this to happen. You have to keep practicing, keep your determination, your orientation, keep going, and it will just eventually this will dawn upon you, and you begin to feel that you've been really profoundly affected. It's reverberating very profoundly. You can't force the reverberation to happen. Don't force anything on the path. Don't force anything. Sure, it takes a little longer. People are in such a hurry right now. They want to force everything. That's materialism. Materialism is really applying force. Heat and pressure. Heat and pressure to things, to alter them. And so materialists want to utilize force on the spiritual path, thinking they can just force the change they need. It's barking up the wrong tree. So really, secular materialism is a disaster as far as the spiritual path goes. Because the attitude is that, well, we should be able to force it. If we can't force it, then it must not even be there at all. That's their conclusion. So they're not willing to spend 2 hours of gently looking at a situation. They say they're going to force it in 10 minutes. You know, they'll do their breathing exercises, all this. It's all designed to force. That's all force. That path of all these types of yoga practices, breathing practices, all these various things are for spiritual materialists trying to force the issue. It's not the way. It's kind of like, well, if I just hold my breath long enough, pow, you know, it's going to pop. You know, it's pressure. Put the pressure on. Here, we're simply in the mood of repentance. Gentle, patient, persistent, kind, compassionate looking, having compassion for our suffering, our delusion, our confusion, our fear, having compassion for the continuity fear. We have compassion for our continuity fear, for sure. See, when I say I have a severe continuity problem, we're expressing compassion for ourselves that we have this severe problem. So out of recognition that we have this very severe problem, we're willing to spend the time gently to, it's such a touchy problem, we can't force it. We'll just make things worse if you try to force it. It just makes things worse. And of course, everybody's saying, look, I've got a lot of classes. I need to get advanced degrees. I've got to make more money. I don't have time. I can maybe, you know, do it in a half an hour. Can I have taken half an hour class and get enlightened? Do I have classes? And you know, there already are so many, you know, enlightenment intensive, enlightenment in 1 hour. Enlightenment 1 hour. This is spiritual materialism. You know, Shankara was not a liar. Jesus is not a liar. Nandamayama is not a liar. Buddha is not a liar. Shankara is not a liar, I should say. You know, all the ones that have told us, hey, this is a lifetime plan. It can take a lifetime. Hopefully shorter, but you can't force it. Cannot be a spiritual materialist and succeed. Enlightenment in 1 hour. What about the continuity problem? What you have is you have a personality that thinks that it's enlightened in these intensives and stuff. You convince the personality, you're enlightened. Right, the fusion light is okay. I'm a light and that's great. Now go out and enlighten other personalities, they say. Okay, I can do that. I'm an enlightened personality. What they're doing is they're telling the personality that they can succeed. So the personality is saying, well, I'm a successful personality, and so that is an enlightened personality. That's really what it amounts to. That we're all succeeding at what we're trying. In fact, it's for sure it's going to succeed. So you might as well just pat yourself on the back and say, the personality is the success. It succeeds. It is. Personality is successful. So therefore, you're enlightened. You're everything you need to be already. You already got it. You already got the personality. Congratulations. You know, you are the person. You are that one person. You are the self, the personal self. And so people say, hey, that was easy. Yeah. Nice continuity to that. Didn't have to look at anything. Just agreed with my programming. So in a spiritually materialistic world, you don't really have the kind of effort that is required. Who can afford it? Who can afford it? Well, here we are on a weekend, Sunday. I'm spending like a couple hours in the morning here. Well, why not? Why not? I don't know why anybody else can't do that. In the evening, spend a couple hours in the evening. Why can't anyone else do that? I'm sure everybody has a few hours in the evening they can spend. In the mornings, on the weekends, why not? We really have to go out and give evidence of being a successful personality. That's what everybody's doing. They're frantically going about trying to build their personal resume. Whereas we're just here carefully looking at this dynamic and practicing the continuity technique and actually feeling this tremendous reverberation of, oh my gosh. I believe I'm waking up from my coma. I can feel it. I mean, I can feel, I know I'm waking up from my coma. So, would we rather spend the effort to waken from our coma, or would we rather just say, hey, the coma's good, the coma's fine, the coma's enlightenment? That's what, 1 hour enlightenment. Guess what, folks, the coma is enlightened. It is enlightenment. The coma as it is enlightenment, everyone. So, you got it already. You're already there. Already there. Your coma is it. That's what the world is doing. That's what secular materialists do. And they you know, do all this force, pressure, heat, pressure, intensity to force some sort of effect or something, some psychic effect. And say, see, look what you can do. Isn't that amazing? Your coma is home. You're already home. Your coma is your home. Yeah, that's all that it is. And then, of course, later comes all the projections. Like if you feel ill at ease, you say, hey, there's some interloper trying to disturb my coma, my happiness. So they need to be extinguished. That they're interfering with my happiness. Not realizing this interference comes from within, from truth within. if they're convinced that the coma is their happiness, then any feeling of instability they feel, they say, well, it must be someone else doing this to me, forcing it upon me. So I have a right to attack them because they're attacking me. Someone's attacking me. This is the result of spiritual materialism is conflict, war. We have, you know, the ancient history of the Indian civilization talks about this advanced race in the past. And they were gods and goddesses. They were spiritual materialists. And what do? Fought these terrific wars in the air using atomic weapons and stuff. Absolutely. It's not mythological. It actually happened. Those are spiritual materialists. That's where we're at now. We're in this, the Kali Yuga, the dark ages, the Iron Age, very dark, and we're super spiritual materialistic, and therefore we're trying to force everything, and we are projecting on what our instability of our position of trying to say our coma is our happiness. We project that out on everyone else and saying that they're causing me disturbance, they're disturbing me intentionally. We refuse to acknowledge that we have a continuity problem, right? So this leads to conflict, it leads to war. The wars in the past, the distant past, were between these great, grandiose spiritual materialists with their gaudiness and their grandiosity and their technology and all this stuff. We're right there. We're right there now. We're right there. History repeating itself. Spiritual materialism is a disaster. It's why Longchenpa, the Tibetan Dzogchen tradition, says don't pass this information out. Don't pull people in to it who aren't ready for it, which is very true. You know, in other words, at that time, of course, they're, in other words, don't teach this at a monastery of all the young monks coming in and saying this is the truth, because that was a way of life for them. Here, it's different. I can mention it on a video or something. That's a different story, because people either pick it up or they won't pick it up, either interested or not interested. But there, you know, you had a total culture of religious education. That was their education. So they were a captive audience, all these people. You don't teach this radical Dzogchen to a captive audience, okay? That's what he's talking about. Because then they'll get the wrong idea. And the radical Dzogchen was brought to the West, and the spiritual materialists got the wrong idea from it, for sure. You know, some got the right idea, and a lot got the wrong idea. Because it seemed to be fast. It's just what the spiritual materialists were looking for. Hey, instant enlightenment. Can I set up a seminar? I can set up these seminars. Boom, 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 boom. And we've got it, and we don't need to waste any more time on this, because we've got, you know, we're succeeding. We're succeeding. We're happy with our success. We're succeeding, and we're happy with our success. But what are we really doing? We're trying to blackmail God, actually. We're trying to convince God to admit that loss is possible. In fact, loss has happened. It's happened. We try to say, God, just admit it. If you admit it, we will stop pretending that we're all sick and suffering and mortal. But you just have to admit it. You know, we're in this game of chicken with God, which is foolish because it's impossible. Loss can never happen. So, time idly spent on our part. Time idly spent. That's all. We've been in this game of chicken with God. We're driving our car towards this cliff, you know. and just keep the cliff keeps receding. We're still driving, and we look over, and God's not even there, not even in a car. We're just playing chicken with ourselves. And you realize this, and you just stop the car and get out. And say, that's enough of that. That's ridiculous. So as we're driving this car towards the cliff, just say, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a chicken problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a blackmail problem. I have a continuity problem. That's true. We don't have a blackmail problem. God is not being blackmailed. And if God is not being blackmailed, we are not being blackmailed. See what I'm saying here? We don't have a chicken problem. We're not playing chicken with God. God is not involved. So if God's not involved, we're not involved. So as we're driving this car, you say, I have a continuity problem. The vision of oneness is the only value there is. And we start slowing the car down. See, we don't want to just pop the door and leap out of the car when it's going 100 miles an hour. Put the brakes on, slow it down, and stop the car, and then get out of the car. And then you're free of the car. So what we're practicing is slowing down this car by saying, I have a continuity problem. Every time we say, the only problem is a continuity problem, we lift our pressure up on the accelerator a little bit. We lift it up a little bit. All right, I probably hit the 2-hour mark here, or maybe went over it. That's okay, it's fine. But that's all that YouTube can handle. I can do part one and part two, and I can do it that way too. So we're just easing up on the accelerator, just easing up. I don't have an accelerator problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a God problem, I have a continuity problem. I do not have a loss problem, I have a continuity problem. The loss problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. I don't have a loss problem. I don't have an identity problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem I have. The identity problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. We can feel ourselves slowing down. We're breaking our foot off the accelerator a little bit and feel like this slowdown, like, wow. The pool is getting shallower. You know, we look at the pool and say, oh, that's not so bad getting in the pool. It's very shallow. I thought it was really deep, but no, it's shallow. The shallow part of the pool gets larger and larger. The deep end, just a little bit there, but there's plenty of room here in the shallow end of the pool. Imagine this big, huge pool. There's this huge area that's all shallow, and there's just one area that's deep. Okay, just one area deep, but we're far away from that. We can get in the pool and relax and just sit in the pool, and we don't have any worries about that deep area over there. This one is just... really hitting hard. The loss problem has absolutely no value. Zero value to me. No value to me. No value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value. The vision of oneness is the only value that there is for me. is the only value there is. Vision of oneness is what I truly value. It's the only value. Just getting into the shallow end of the pool here, that's all. Very shallow end of the pool. Now, is there anything going on? Is there all sorts of imagery? No, nothing, nothing. My mind is like blank, sort of. It's just, I feel this kind of deep sort of action or strain, action. It's some deep level of like the nervous system, of the feeling system, of the perceptual system, something really deep down. It's sort of a deep down ache throughout the whole body, as it were, and a sort of a deep, subtle reverberation of this. But as far as my thoughts, mind, everything, no, nothing is taking place there. So, I mean, functionality is exactly the same. My mind is not racing at all. It's quiet. It's calm. Movements of my body, expression is the same. Everything feels the same, but there is this sort of a deep down ache. Like the fundamental levels, layers, the fundamental layers are somehow being hosed down or, you know, pressure washed or something. It's like, wow. But superficially, everything is the same. Birds are still eating the berries. Chimes are still ringing. Everything's exactly the same. But the deep psyche, as it were, there's something an event taking place, something profound taking place. You know, just a profound realization, reorientation. Just to admit that I don't have a loss problem. I have a continuity problem. All these people screaming they're trapped. The fact is, they're not trapped. I don't have a trapped problem. I don't have an imprisonment problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a hostage problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have an entrapment problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have against my will problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem that I have. The against my will problem has no value. Only the vision of oneness has value. Now, of course, it's possible by movement, moving around, getting active, you can distract your superficial attention from this. So, I neither put my attention on it or nor off of it. It's kind of just remain in the mood of repentance at the level of practice, instead of trying to focus on how you feel too much and trying to force anything. No, just aware, yeah, there is this effect, sure, I'm aware of it. But the determination is on the level of practicing. Buddha said, take the middle path. That's what Buddha's talking about, so to speak, is in your practicing, don't try and force it. And don't try to distract yourself from it. Neither one. Stay in that middle path of repentance and right spiritual practice. let the effects, results take care of themselves, but don't try and force anything and don't try to distract yourself away either. You know, you're aware that there's a profound reaction. Don't deny it. Just be with it. Just stay with it. And don't try to intensify it through directly focusing on it. This is at real meditation, actually. We're actually doing real meditation. But there's no need to call it meditation. We're just focusing on the continuity problem is all we're doing. Again, meditation now has this connotation of fast food spirituality. I shouldn't be able to meditate for an hour, close my eyes, watch my breath, and after that I should be enlightened, should be relaxed and enlightened and feeling good about myself. Okay, so it's got that connotation. Now this is different. Because I've gotten just this profound reaction to this, and it's continuing. It's waking up from our coma. Really, meditation is really waking up from your coma into the vision of oneness. That's all that it is. It's the gradual, gentle, intelligent, conscious waking up from our coma and managing. It's managing the awakening from our coma. That's what meditation really is. It's not just this, let me stare at a wall and watch my thoughts or breath. Okay. It's the overall managing of the waking from the coma. Because when you get these kind of results that I'm getting, you know, that has to be managed. And so that's why I say the mood of repentance is all important. The basic commitment and confession, I have a continuity problem, in the context of this humble mood of repentance, saying I have a severe problem, and it's a very difficult, tricky problem, and I need to really have compassion for myself here. That's what's needed. Don't force the issue. Press the issue, but don't force it. In genuine retreats, you have those who have had this profound reactions to what they're doing, and they're sitting there quietly, not speaking or anything, but you can walk by and you don't need to say, hey, how you doing? No. But you're not in some trance state. Either. They're not in a trance state. You're not in a trance state. It's just you recognize that they may not want to be talking. But if they need to, they can say, hello, how are you? That's it, yeah. They're totally functional. But sitting quietly, is you're managing your success, is what you're doing. So you just assume they're managing their success. And let them be. In a satsang, for instance, or prayer meeting, whatever you want to call it, after you go through this intensive continuity problem practice, there should be a time of silence, of sitting, nobody talking. And when you feel that you're ready to leave, you just silently and quietly leave. There may be people that stay in there for hours. It may take them that long to get accustomed to this acceptance, like, wow, the shock of the compassion that they've given to themselves, the shock that they're waking up. They need time to just adjust to it. So they may stay 2, 3, 4 hours. Some might stay the whole night or whatever. I mean, it's possible. When you have a real something really profound, you just need to sit quietly. Others may not really have had much of a reaction, a breakthrough, or response, so they can leave pretty soon, a couple minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, whatever. Others will stay a long time. And again, what are my thoughts? No thoughts in particular. Am I trying to stop my thoughts? No. It's just, I'm just feeling this. This sort of inner strain. It's sort of a wow feeling. You're like, wow. Neither watching it too closely nor not watching it. Just kind of waiting, just kind of waiting. Sort of this attentive waiting. I think you might call it a patient, attentive waiting. And just abiding with it. Just abiding with it. Giving it time. It's like a newborn child almost, you know, just giving it time. Waking up from our coma. We're looking around saying, oh my gosh, you know, I don't have a loss problem. I don't have a will problem. I don't have these problems. And it's just like, you know, it's like catching your first new breath or something. So let yourself catch your breath. It's kind of like catching your breath after running a marathon. You're just catching your breath now. Actually, we ran a marathon. We spent, a couple hours. Top runners do it in a couple hours plus. So we just ran this marathon. Now we're catching our breath. I think it's really important. Now, something the Catholic Church does, which is right, yeah, I mean, they do some things right, they do some things that I think they are not so right. But the church doors should be kept open after any service in any situation where you're trying to focus on truth. You should be able to sit where you are and remain sitting there. And some people do, they remain in prayer. After the Mass is over, they remain in prayer there for a long time. Nobody's telling them to leave. Nobody comes up and says, hey, shakes them, hey, you need to leave. The door should remain unlocked. Church door should remain unlocked. Temple door should remain unlocked. There should not be any time pressure on you leaving. It's important to point out I am not anti-religion at all. I'm just, what I do is I just notice. If I see mistakes, I say this is something that needs to be corrected. It's not a judgment. It just says something, you know, something's gotten twisted here. It's not right at this point. Mistakes only need to be corrected, not punished or anything like that. But leaving the doors open, unlocked, no pressure on people, that is super important, super important, super important. You cannot have this seminar and you go see this non-do teacher, and they rent a room for an hour, boom, 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 you got it, you are not, you know, this, whatever. And then, okay, we've got to leave now, lock up the door, boom, you're out driving home. That is not right. How can you really allow yourself to truly feel the depth of it when you're under this time pressure? You gotta jump in your car and drive home. That's why I say really that I prefer like a train-based society or a walking society, someplace where you can walk, where transportation is not you have to drive your car, because definitely driving a car will knock this out of you, for the most part. Now I've had breakthroughs while driving, for sure, actually a lot, but usually it's sort of midday and the roads are not crowded and I'm used to driving constantly all day. But just the idea of getting in a car and checking the mirror, checking the gas, driving, you know, it really is very distracting. If you're on a long drive, you can get into it, right? Because you realize I got another an hour of driving, and you can cool down that way. Okay. Train-based society, walk to the train station, get on the train. You're not operating any machinery. You're not navigating all the traffic or anything. And so that's better. It's better. But certainly, this idea, you go to a satsang, and then after prayers, boom, 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 program's over, everybody leaves, you're out on the street. What is that? Now, if you really are making progress, you're going to be just floored. You know, you're going to be floored, somewhat floored by it. You're waking up from a long, long coma. You don't roll the gurney out on the street. By retreats, the good retreats would have these little huts or something. You walk to the central area of continuity practice, then you can just walk back slowly to your little hut and sit there and watch the sunset, and everything is, you're not pressured to operate any machinery. You're not pressured to referee interpersonal conflicts. You're not pressured to do anything except sit there quietly. You're not pressured to do that, but there's not games, there's not a basketball game going on, there's not a television set to distract you. And again, I'm not criticizing retreats. They can be very helpful, actually. Can be. There's lots of ways to go about it. But you can do it right in your own house, as I'm doing, just right here. Sunday morning. You can have a retreat right where you are. But again, you don't want to be physically engaged. That really tends, for me, it tends to knock it out real badly. Real badly. I find that a lot of certain types of physical activity causes me to get an extremely negative state of mind. Working in the garden, landscaping, cleaning up, doing this and that, I get into an extraordinarily bad, it seems like all the wickedness takes over. It's like, wow, what's happening? It's terrible. I find sitting very still is the most helpful. As far as activity, I like golf because there's a lot of times when you can just stand very still, very quiet. You're very quiet out there. Other people are playing, you're not saying a word. So a lot of the time you're completely silent and you're waiting for others. You're just sitting, you're just standing there very still and quiet. What do? You're just looking at the beauty of where you are and just feeling, listening, feeling the vibe of the place and not doing anything. As you're waiting for others to hit, then it's your turn, okay, you go up there, hit, and then you're just slowly making your way through nature. You know, it's pretty easy to operate a golf cart. I can tape video, it's pretty easy, you're going real slow. So I find that going slowly through nature, standing still, not talking, All of those things are engulfed, and you're using a beautiful place. So it doesn't disturb me that it's not such a bad thing, really. But it's not as good as sitting still. It's not as good as sitting still. For a prolonged period of time. That's the best. But like a 2-3 hour of sitting quietly, sitting still, focusing in like this. That's the most helpful, most effective. But we do need some recreation. We do need to move about a little bit, exercise a little bit. Some people take walks. They like that. And it doesn't seem to do it too much for me. But some seem to be able to focus on walks. Some jog. They can do it that way. Different. Some actually think, actually work in the garden. They actually think it helps or something. But I would say the sitting still is by far and away the most effective. Of course, that's difficult for young people. So I'd say for young people, is you lessen the time, make a more intense effort, lessen the time, but still make sure you give it a little extra time to cool down. Don't jump into activity. Don't make a sudden break into activity after you've done this intense continuity practice. Sort of gradually get back into whatever activity you're doing. Don't leap into it. It'll be too jarring, and it'll frighten you the next time. Next time it'll be more superficial. You'll say, "Well, I was too jarring for me, so I don't want to get into any in-depth effects of it. Really, I don't want too much progress here." So, if you're a young, active person, maybe a stretch afterwards, or eat a little something. You gotta figure it out. Everyone has to figure it out for themselves. But don't leap into intense activity. Don't jump into a video game, okay? All this shooting and driving, whatever, intense. Don't get into that. Don't be watching the gruesome television stuff or whatever. You know, for me, like what I'll do now is actually I'll go in and I'll turn on the golf tournament from Bay Hill. Watch a little golf. See, very mellow. Very mellow. But then chat a little bit, maybe, you know, and get into it that way probably. That's a smooth transition out of it. The effects are still there with me. They're still very, very profound here. So this again, is really not going away, which is good. Good. They're very welcome to stay. Very welcome to stay. Okay. Gonna wrap it up at this point. So, great effort. Great effort here. Which is what's required. It is simply what's required. And don't let anybody tell you otherwise. Okay? That's it.